Dignity and care is really an approach to providing care to patients and families. It's something that emerged out of a program of research that we've been conducting in the area of dignity. Many people give lip service to the fact that dignity is a core value, a core goal that they try and achieve in terms of the care they deliver. And yet very few people really know what does it mean to help people to die with dignity? What does it mean to help patients who aren't even necessarily terminally ill, but to receive care that might be supportive of their dignity during the course of receiving health care? So through a course of various different studies, we've discovered many things about dignity, and we've discovered ways of trying to operationalize how dignity in care can be delivered. And it has various core elements, but I suppose one of the key issues is being sure that in the course of healthcare that we treat our patients not just in terms of the ailment that they have, but in terms of the person, the people that they are and continue to be. It's said that all of us who are in healthcare have to be responsible for what are called the ABCs of critical care, and they refer to airway, breathing, circulation. No physician, no healthcare provider can claim to be competent if they don't take responsibilities for those core efficiencies. And when it comes to the humanities of care, what I notice is that there are no or were no core efficiencies. We tell people to act out of a sense of beneficence, be a good person, trust your gut, and hopefully you don't get into trouble when it comes to the interpersonal connections that you might try and forge with patients. And yet, we know that many people get into trouble. Many people do end up doing things in the course of care, even though they may be well-intentioned, that are hurtful or assaultive or somehow just dismissive of that person. And so the ABCDs are something that I developed as a way of trying to say, these are core efficiencies of the humanities of care. And they should be things that are completely, non-optional. If you're going to be working with human beings, then these are the things that all of us should be accountable for. I mean, oftentimes, you hear people say, of a care provider, well, they're a good surgeon, they're a good technician. They're very competent. But the reality is that we're dealing with human beings. So if you're technically very competent and you can't embrace what I call the core efficiencies of humane care, then perhaps the automobile industry is a better place that you'd be suited to exercise those technical competencies. A stands for attitude. Your attitude, that is you, the healthcare provider, have an attitude that is going to have a profound impact on patient experience. Even though that sounds like I'm pontificating, we have evidence to the effect that that is absolutely true. We've done studies in which we've looked at what's most predictive of whether or not patients experience their dignity as being intact versus not. And certainly attitude, the way people perceive themselves to be seen. I wrote a paper called Dignity in the Eye of the Beholder. So the reflection that people are looking at in your eye is one that ought to be affirming of their sense of personhood. So that's the A, attitude. B is for behavior. How do we behave towards patients in a way, again, that can affirm personhood? If our attitude is such that, or at least if we can register that our attitude is such that it is important, that what goes on between our ears has implications in terms of patient experience, then behavior should be adjusted accordingly. So do we meet someone's gaze, or do we avert their gaze? Do we stand at the bedside? Do we sit at the bedside? How distracted are we by things like an overhead pager or a BlackBerry or an iPhone? these things have become so common in, you know, everyday interactions that we tend to ignore them. We tend to see them as part of the background noise. And yet, if you're a patient in a bed and feeling vulnerable, and your healthcare provider seems not 100% there, somewhat distracted, it's not far-fetched to think that you may not feel like you are the sole focus of that person's attention. And so behavior can be these subtleties. And I once talked about this to an oncology nurse who told me that she thought of it as the fragrance of care. They're all of those things that patients can pick up on that say whether or not you care, whether or not you're paying attention, whether or not you matter or don't. C is for compassion, and this is one that tends to be the most contentious in that, how do we teach compassion? Is it in fact something that's innate? Can it be taught? One of the things that I've written about in terms of the ABCDs of dignity conserving care is that to feel compassion, I think you yourself have to be in touch with your own vulnerability. Why is that important? I think it's important because without knowing that you too, like your patient, are vulnerable, it really is impossible to put yourself in their place. To be compassionate is to try and understand another person's suffering and the wish to be responsive to it. Well, how do you do that? I think the way to understand is to know that you too may walk a very similar path. I've sometimes likened it to trying to describe the taste of ice cream. If you haven't been there, if you haven't had that experience, you can talk about it now to the end of time, and you're still not going to impart exactly what that's about. So getting back to the C for compassion, to feel compassion, to try and invoke compassion, you yourself have to understand that there's very little that separates you from your patient. Just a bit of time, perhaps, a bit of luck. But eventually, I mean, we all follow a path that leads us to vulnerability. D is for dialogue. These are the conversations that take place between healthcare providers and their patients. But they're conversations, again, that need to somehow acknowledge or be mindful of issues around personhood. Some people use the rationalization that, you know, if we start to broach issues around personhood, that'll take far too much time. You know, I have a busy clinic. People are lined up already. How can I possibly start to get into conversations that address personhood and expect that I'm going to complete all of the tasks, the more technical tasks, if you will, that face me? And while there's probably, I mean, there's an element of truth that we're all overtaxed and there's not enough time, the reality is that sometimes it takes very little time to acknowledge not just the patient, but the person. So sometimes it takes no words at all. It's a look in the eye. It can be a hand on a shoulder. It can be something as simple as, I'm sorry that it's going this way, or I know this isn't the news that you hoped for. It can be these subtleties, these small things that make the difference between feeling that you, the patient, are being processed versus this is a meaningful, important interaction that's happening between you and another human being.